Herb Kressel, editor of Radiology, and welcome to a special edition of the Radiology Podcast. Today I'm joined by Dr. Stephen Thomas, Professor Emeritus of Radiology and Medical Physics at the University of Cincinnati. Welcome, Dr. Thomas.
Greetings, Dr. Kressel. Happy to be here.
Yes, I was delighted that you were able to contribute to our Golden Oldies selection. What was the experience like for you? How did you approach it?
I took that as a compliment and an honor to be asked to participate in this. And as a medical physicist and a scientist in radiology, I took it as my objective and my focus to look at the scientific aspects that were presented in the early papers and to draw attention, if I could, to those papers which brought up a new innovative technique that shaped the development and the practice of radiology, that helped on the pathway of bringing clinical practice into standard operation. So I started by actually looking at the 250 papers, or some of them anyway, that were provided by your office, those papers that were most cited from back in the 1940s or so, up until I think into the 70s. But at that point, I realized that there might be other surprises, given the fact that radiology's first edition came out in 1923. So I did indeed say, I'm going to start at the beginning and look at the various papers up until basically the present time. And again, the focus being on the scientific aspect of those papers.
I see. Now, it's an interesting, your observation about not using citations as the sole figure of merit is very right on. In fact, we realize the same thing. And if you look from 1920 to 1940, if you had 50 citations, that was an enormous number. It sort of reflects the growth of medical publication rather than the objective quality of the science, just kind of the difference in those periods. So we actually had to generate a separate list of the earlier ones and just cut them sort of to like 50 or so citations, and that would make it sort of a top-cited article for that period. Very, very interesting thing. So were there any surprises that you had in going through the list?
Well, I think one of the surprises, and actually something that appealed to me, I thought, was the fact that the number of basic scientists that had contributed to the early phases of radiation in medicine, and in particular, of course, in radiology. And the fact that actually that Compton of scattering fame, actually in 1924 had an article that was published. And that to me was significant, the fact that he was introducing this extremely important concept at that early stage, that was
right,
even before he got Nobel Prize, into medicine. So these kind of things that popped out at me as a scientist working hand in hand with the clinicians, the radiologists, that was something that I found very rewarding.
I think it's a very pertinent observation. The multidisciplinary, the recognition of the importance of combining the clinical with the technical and basic science was really part of our legacy. And that's, if anything, grown over the years. And I think it's definitely a strength of our field. I noticed you had this article by Lauriston Taylor on precise measurement of dose. And he has an interesting background, and the whole thrust of his effort in trying to quantify dose, I think, is very, very important. Do you have any thoughts about that article?
Well, you stated it, I think, very nicely. The fact that Laurie Taylor, as he was called, he was working with the National Bureau of Standards in Washington, D.C., and at an early stage in this article that I quoted and that I pulled out as a golden oldie with him as the author, 1930 was the date on that one. And he subsequently, there was many other articles written by him and by others. And the quest, which was critical, was the fact that they had to come up with precise methodology for measuring the radiation dose for the procedures that were performed in radiology. And the fact that he, as a scientist, and others recognized this fact, and that the expertise that he could provide in trying to define the methodology to measure radiation dose in a precise way. And that was a key word, precise. Of course, the National Bureau of Standards, you would expect the term precise to be there. But indeed, they put all their expertise and energy into doing this, and it was a very helpful aspect of these individuals during this early time of radiology.
You know, your comments bring me to thinking about the early days of MRI and how the college was instrumental in organizing a uniform nomenclature for the different terms, the repetition time, the echo time. I remember reading some of the early MR papers, and everyone was referring to the terms quite differently. And it was hard to sort of understand what was going on from one paper to the next. And so I think developing quantitative definitions and standards for our tools was very, very important. I certainly agree with that. I also noted that you cited in your list a paper by Edith Quimby from 1938. Not too many women physicists, I would imagine, in 1938, and from what I gather, she was quite a character.
Well, didn't know her personally, but she did have a reputation, and she was another one of these individuals who paid attention to detail, very precise in her work. So she was recognized as a pioneer in these early years in getting protocols for therapeutic use of radiation in radiology. And this particular paper, in 1938, she was entitled A Dosage Chart for X-Ray Therapy. What she did, which was so important, is she looked at a very complicated subject and worked out protocols for presenting it to the practicing radiologist in a way that could be understood, and more importantly, in a way that it could be applied to the field without a lot of extra effort. It was presented in a way that would be understandable, usable, and practical. And this is exactly what was needed. Edith Quimby published landmark papers for many years after that, up into the 50s, even within radiology, as well as others.
Wow. Another article that you highlighted that got my attention was the article by Kuhl and Edwards on image separation radioisotope scanning. I think, if I'm not mistaken, a lot of people kind of view that as kind of the flip side of the early identification of the basis of CT scanning as well. And there was talk about Dr. Kuhl, sort of, should he be in the overall importance of this paper in the full in all of medical imaging. Any thoughts about this one?
Exactly. I mean, this was in 1963, and you're exactly right. This is in nuclear medicine, and if you look at the history of what I'll call CT techniques, and that image, and he referred to it as feature separation at depth in this early paper. And so he just led the way to the developments in being able to quantitate, in this case, activity. It was radioactivity, but it could be any quantitate, any feature in an image within given sections of the body. And so this led to, this work really led to the development of tomographic image presentation. And it, in 1963, of course, predated the use of X-ray CT, but it was critical in terms of setting the foundation for this type of image processing and image presentation.
Yeah, David Kuhl is certainly a giant, but my impression is that his overall contribution remains understated.
Well, I think so, you know, and he went on, he didn't stop with that paper, so he went on to publish other papers in nuclear medicine with regard to instrumentation and tomographic instrumentation. And yes, I mean, he got overshadowed, I would say, through the years as X-ray CT came on. But those of us in the field realized, and particularly those in nuclear medicine, realized the contribution that he made and how he really started things moving forward on this new development of tomographic and slice presentation.
Now, as you said, most of the papers that you listed were more basic papers, but you do have Paul New's first description of using the EMI scanner for CT of the head. That I remember, that was a big head turner. I think there are a few papers that I can recall that got more attention internationally and in the media than that paper.
Yeah, when I was at that point, that was in the 70s, 1974 was that particular paper. And it was, of course, it was providing data and input and what was learned from the EMI scanner, which was the only one out there basically at that time. And I really struggled with which paper would I put my finger on right there, because there were a number in that same year, because
right.
All of a sudden, event, the EMI scanner as an event, took over radiology, and the impact was very visible with regard to how it would affect the future of radiology. And so there was a number of papers at that same time, within that same year anyway, that looked at the physical aspects of CT scanners. They were more the scientific side of it and how they worked and what their resolution capabilities were, those sort of aspects on the scientific side. But they were really geared, I think, by this presentation of the experience with something like 300 different examinations that Paul and his group had reviewed and put forth. So that's what I ended up doing, picking this one in my list as being significant and showing that horizon.
You know, you raise a very interesting point, because as we were going through the list, when you get to these big kind of breakthrough things, you frequently find a cluster of papers in the same year. That's understood. But what we also see is that frequently the first descriptions are fairly primitive, and from a scientific basis, maybe the work is not well laid, you know, it's not neatly tied up. It's kind of really, it looks like just first impressions. And what we've noticed is that in terms of people's view of the golden oldies, it's very common that people look for the first thoroughly vetted kind of presentation and the new paper with having a larger series and a broader type of analysis. That seems to be the one that sticks and gets cited more and more commonly. And sometimes maybe the more exciting preliminary papers get kind of overlooked. And it's, you know, we wrestled with that all throughout this process. And in general, we took the somewhat larger, more well-developed series. But sometimes we did revert to kind of these early looks, because they're just so nifty to see sort of the first glimpse of something that became very, very important.
Actually, that's one of the ways that I viewed this as I looked. And in fact, in general, I did not want to look at reviews or you know, things that were doing a review of the literature and that sort of thing. This particular one by Paul New was the closest to that, although that was examinations that their group had done. But one of my techniques in reviewing each of these articles would be to look in the citations, that is, look in the bibliography citations the authors gave in their own particular article. And there I was trying to just verify originality.
Mm-hmm.
They were quoting people all the time that had done this. That, you know, sort of took a little bit of the luster away from the papers. And so I was in particular looking for things which were original, for most of the papers that I selected here, and some of which we've discussed already.
Yeah, the last paper I want to sort of have a little discussion on is the Le Bihan paper on imaging intravoxal incoherent motions. And I know you were very active in the early sort of MR days. And my recollection, when the paper came out, there was like a lot of buzz about it. And a lot of people just didn't believe it. And the problem was that the instrumentation that we had was pretty crude. And it really wasn't until the instrumentation got better and better that we started to realize a lot of the concepts that Lebihan and colleagues put forward on those early papers. And now, of course, diffusion has just taken off and we're seeing more about IVIM. And so I thought it's kind of interesting how you have something that's theoretically very well grounded, but sometimes the technology doesn't allow us to fully develop the applications areas and it lags a little bit. What are your recollections of when this paper came out?
Well, I mean, at that time, in fact, again, as I was reviewing the work for the Golden Oldies, there was a lot of papers that after this that had a lot more powerful imagery, and the techniques have been sophisticated, much more sophisticated than in this earlier paper by the BN. But the fact is that all of those papers that I started looking through would refer back to him. So this, again, is my attempt to look at people who came out with original ideas that served as the springboard for many others. And even though at that time this paper came out, it was probably under recognized in terms of the significance it would have. But those who were working in the field certainly picked up on it. And that's where the strength of some of these early authors and the works of these authors come, that they put the seed of the idea out there. And as you stated, it may not, when they were working with it, the technology and the development of it, of that particular modality might not have been the most glorious, I'll use that term, but yet the seed was there, and others could follow on that and use that. If it wasn't for that seed, the sprouts would not have shot up.
Exactly. You know, I talked to Denny about this, and I don't know if you know, but when he was started this work, he was interested in the liver. But the motion effects were so severe that he was never able to really do it in the liver at that time. So he moved to the central nervous system because it was kind of more feasible technically. And now, of course, with our improved magnet technology and acquisitions and gradients, we can kind of do it throughout the body with much, much less problems. So it's kind of interesting. Even his own work, he had to kind of adapt to the limitations of technology at the time. So very fascinating. Anyway, I want to really thank you for your work in generating the list, and it's been a pleasure speaking with you about it.
Well, thank you, Herman. And as I said, I enjoyed this, and the fact that this 100th anniversary of the RSNA, and that you're presenting these, I think it's an aspect that people find very enjoyable and educational. Looking through the list,
Hopefully.
I enjoy being able to play a small part in that.
Well, it was a pleasure, and I thank you again for your contribution. Very nice speaking with you. Have a good day.
Okay, thank you, Herman.
You're
Bye-bye
welcome.
now.
Bye.